In the Quran's chapter of the spider, Surah Al-Ankabut, God asks a rhetorical question. Is mankind unaware of how God originated life? And since most of us are not paleontologists, the scientists who study prehistoric life, we are largely unaware of how life started. That is why the very next verse in the Quran encourages us all to find out. Qul siru fil ardh fa andhuru kayfa bada'a al-khalq. Say, go all through the earth and behold how he began the creation of life in the first instance. And maybe that is what the prophet Moses tried to do. According to the Quran and the authentic sayings of the prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, Moses was asked if he knew anyone more knowledgeable than he. And he replied that he didn't. So God inspired him to seek one who was, a man named Al Khidr, the green one, who got his name because when he sat on barren white land, it turned green with vegetation. So what kind of knowledge might Moses have been seeking from a man like that? Perhaps Moses' journey is linked somehow to how life on earth developed. When Moses asked how he would find the green one, he was told a fish would be his sign. According to the Quran's chapter of the cave, Surah Al-Kahf, Moses and his servant walked a long distance in search of the green one. After a while, Moses tired, but he said he wouldn't stop until he reached the place where the two bodies of water met, Majma' al-Bahrain, which is where they eventually rested. However, the servant boy was amazed to see that the fish that they had been carrying all this time had escaped into the water and swam away. Moses only found out about the fish escaping later on in the journey and realized that the place of the two bodies of water was the spot they were looking for, and he returned to it. Sure enough, there is where they found the green one, Al-Khidr. Moses asked the green one if he could follow him and learn from him, but he replied Moses wouldn't be patient. And how could he be patient given his current level of understanding, which is bound by his experience? وَكَيْفَ تَصْبُرُ عَلَى مَا لَمْ تُحِيطْ بِهِ خُبْرًا. It is interesting that the green one didn't say Moses didn't have intelligence or ability. He said he didn't have context and information. This is an important point. Clearly, we are now interpreting verses in the Quran in the context of modern science, something that early Muslims couldn't do. The Quran's verses on the formation of the solar system, for example, for the benefit of people who lived when science hadn't caught up with the Quran, these verses are coded in symbolism, which only becomes apparent once our understanding and experience advance enough. The story of Moses and the Green One is unique to Islam and is not found in any other religious tradition. Most Muslim scholars still view it as historical. What is clear, however, is that it is also metaphorical, with deep symbolic meaning. In linguistics, semiotics is the science of signs, and it attempts to unlock a text's hidden meaning. The story with Moses and the Green One is replete with symbolism. For example, Moses represents us, the learner. We experience events through him. Al-Khidr, the green one, likely represents life on land, as evidenced by how he got his nickname. The two bodies of water, al-Bahrain, are mentioned 5 times in the Quran, and as we shall see, represent marine life development. The hadith explicitly states that the fish is a sign, and it beautifully ties everything together. Before continuing the story of Moses and the Green One, we need to know more about what paleontologists have discovered to understand the meaning behind the two bodies of water. Paleontologists study prehistoric life by examining fossils, and they have found evidence of life that existed 3.5 billion years ago called stromatolites. Stromatolites are rock formations made by the deposits of living microbes called cyanobacteria. It is impossible to exaggerate the importance of cyanobacteria in the history of life on Earth. Not only are they one of the earliest life forms and probably the most numerous to have ever lived on the planet, but they still exist today. If you have ever lived near a large body of water, you might know cyanobacteria by the common name blue-green algae. Though they are no longer as widespread as they once were, we can still see stromatolites being formed by cyanobacteria in places like the Bahamas and in Shark Bay, Australia. A big question that some paleontologists ask is whether there was life before cyanobacteria. And if so, how was that life created? A theory gaining acceptance is called the lipid world theory. It proposes that life began with lipid molecules, which naturally form primitive cell membranes upon encountering water. These vesicles could encapsulate and concentrate other organic molecules, facilitating the chemical reactions to form RNA and proteins. Lipid barriers would separate the harsh, highly saline environment on the outside from the life-preserving, less salinized water-based cytoplasm on the inside. While protocells aren't living entities as they lack complex metabolism and don't contain genetic information, laboratory experiments have shown that lipid vesicles could form from prebiotic conditions and exhibit properties crucial for life, such as growth, division, and simple metabolic processes. The salinity of the water in Shark Bay can be twice that of regular seawater. The cell membrane of any microbe is critical in maintaining a controlled internal environment, allowing organisms like cyanobacteria to thrive in the challenging external conditions of Shark Bay. In the Quran's chapter entitled The Originator of Creation, Surah Al-Fatir, it describes how one body of water is salty and bitter and the other is fresh, palatable, and pleasant to drink. In other words, one is a harsh environment and the other sustains life. Three other verses discuss how God created a barrier between the two bodies of water. In Surah Al-Naml, or the chapter of the ant, right after verses describing the creation of the earth and skies and plant life, the Quran talks about how life came to be, how the earth is an environment conducive to life, with water and mountains, and then says, وَجَعَلْنَا بَيْنَ الْبَحْرَيْنِ حَاجِزًا, and has placed a barrier between the two bodies of water. What barrier between two waters is conducive to life? Could this barrier, hajizan, be a cell membrane, a barrier between the saline environment and the life-preserving internal cytoplasm? The first biological cells to develop were called prokaryotic, meaning that they had an outer barrier but no internal partitioning. Scientists think that these first prokaryotic cells were likely created about 3.8 to 3.5 billion years ago. Cyanobacteria developed from them. Over the next 1.5 billion years, cyanobacteria would cause increasing oxygen levels in the oceans and subsequently in the atmosphere. Then a new cell architecture evolved. Eukaryotic cells not only had an outer protective membrane like the prokaryotic cells, but also developed internal partitions. Genetic material, like RNA and DNA, became enclosed in a nucleus and the membrane formed organelles. Again, these new eukaryotic cells had an external protective cell membrane and internal partitions. In the Quran, Surah Al-Furqan, God says, and He it is who has given freedom to movement of the two bodies of water, the one sweet and thirst allaying, and the other salty and bitter, and yet has wrought between them a partition and a barrier. Where the Surat Al-Naml seem to be talking about prokaryotic cells, this Surat Al-Furqan seems to be talking about eukaryotic cells with a barrier and partition. SubhanAllah. But there's more. The cell membrane prevents harmful elements from getting in. But even in the earliest cells, water molecules could pass through the cell through special membrane proteins called aquaporins. Aquaporins are critical and crucial to efficient water management for cells, and their presence is widespread across many different types of organisms. So just as this verse says, God gave freedom of movement to water molecules despite the barrier to salt ions that make up the external brackish water body. Double subhanAllah. If we read a bit further in the Quran in Surah Al-Rahman, we find a third time that the Quran talks about this barrier between the two waters. He has given freedom to the two bodies of water so that they might meet, Between them is a barrier which they may not transgress. Which then of your sustainer's powers can you disavow? Out of these two bodies of water come forth pearls and coral reefs. Here we see the barrier between the two waters, Bainahuma Barzajan La Yabrian, has a product, pearls and coral. This is interesting because, first of all, both pearls and coral reefs are made from the same type of material, calcium carbonate, and both are produced by multicellular organisms that developed 500 to 250 million years ago, about 1.5 billion years after the first eukaryotic cells, or 3 billion years after cyanobacteria first appeared. Multicellular organisms and animals have connective tissue that supports and organizes their bodies and interfaces with their shells and skeletons. Is the connective tissue in animals the barrier mentioned in Surah Al-Rahman? Bivalve mollusks produce pearls. The earliest known fossils of mollusks date back to 540 million years ago, and the bivalve group of mollusks developed about 60 million years later. Mollusks are one of the oldest and most diverse groups of animals on the planet. So the third time the barrier is mentioned, it's associated with one of the earliest marine animal life. On the other hand, coral reefs are created by coral polyps. Coral reefs are vital for marine life as well as life on land. With only 1% of the ocean floor, they support 25% of all marine species. And they protect coastlines from the impact of waves and storms. And they are a source of new medicines. And they support commercial and subsistence fisheries. This verse clearly explains that the barrier separating the two waters concerns living organisms. The barrier helps give them a home. Surat al-Fatir mentioned earlier also connects the two bodies of water to marine animals. Yet from both of them, you eat tender seafood. Returning to the story of Moses and the Green One, at the place where the two bodies of water met. Let's recall that the fish that the servant had been carrying survived in the open air for a long time before it escaped into the water. What kind of creature can survive in both water and on land in the open air? In science, we call them amphibians. After the development of protocells, prokaryotic cells, eukaryotic cells, and multicellular marine animals, amphibians would have been the next milestone in the development of life. Triple subhanAllah. This brings us back to the Green One, who relented and allowed Moses to accompany him as long as he stayed silent and patient, which of course you probably know didn't happen. After the Green One put a hole in a ship that they had boarded, Moses accused him of trying to drown its people. After the Green One killed a boy or young man, Moses accused him of murder. After being refused food from the hostile people of a town, the Green One rebuilt a wall in that town that was about to collapse. Moses suggested they could have gotten paid for the work. Before parting ways, the Green One explained his actions. An approaching tyrant king would have stolen the boat, and by sabotaging it, the owners who were poor would not lose it. The young man was corrupt and would have soon overburdened his goodly parents with transgressions and disbelief, and now they could have good offspring. The rebuilt wall helped save a treasure belonging to some orphans that the hostile townsfolk would have stolen had it collapsed. In this way, the orphan's treasure was protected for when they grew old. These three stories are not isolated. They paint a picture. The first story with the hole in the boat, a danger is coming. Avoid it before it reaches you. The second story with the boy, a danger has arrived, eliminate it before it harms you. The third story with the rebuilt wall, a danger has spread around you, protect yourself until you are stronger. The three stories exhort people to take comprehensive, contingent action to maintain peace, order, health, faith, and prosperity. The fish that survived on land and in the sea separates the two stories. One about marine life and God doing God's work of creation of life and order. And the other about life on land and a man doing God's work
of maintaining order and fighting disorder. While the story of the Green One emphasizes divine wisdom beyond human understanding, having patience and humility, and trusting in God's plan, there is a central point to the story that hasn't gotten enough attention. Man's role in maintaining order on Earth by preventing, removing, or defending against danger. When we travel through the Earth to see how God created first life, like the Quran's chapter of the spider says, we also uncover what mankind is doing today. In early 2024, temperatures of ocean waters around the largest coral reef in the world, the Great Barrier Reef, rose to the hottest it had been in four centuries, 1.73 degrees Celsius higher than average, causing significant coral bleaching. At current rates, temperatures will rise another 2 to 4 degrees by the year 2100. Scientists think that a rise of just 2 degrees might be enough to wipe out 99% of the world's coral reefs. The threat to coral reefs is only one of many dangers that global climate change poses. There is still time to take action, and the message of the story of Moses and the Green One tells us that that is what God expects from us.
The point of this video is that God asks us to go through the earth and see how life was first created, which is what paleontologists do. We should learn more about what they are discovering. When the Quran discusses the barrier between two bodies of water, it may be referring to the phospholipid cell membrane. The different ways the two bodies of water as mentioned seem to map out the process of biological evolution, from prokaryotes, eukaryotes, connective tissue and multicellular organisms, and finally leading to amphibians. The fish in the Quran's chapter of the cave seems to be a link between marine and land life, and between God doing God's work to mankind taking up a role in fostering order and harmony in society. If you enjoyed this video, please like, subscribe, and share.